I informed the Senate that at 8:30 a.m. today, 26 proposals were received in accordance with the Standing Order 75, the question of which proposal would be submitted to the Senate was determined by lot. As a result, I informed the Senate that the following letter has been received from Senator Thorpe. Is the proposal supported? I understand that informal arrangements have been made to allocate specific times to each of the speakers in today's debate. With the concurrence of the Senate, I shall ask the clerk to set the clock accordingly. And we have Senator Walters. You have the call.
Thank you very much, Acting Deputy President. And I rise to speak on the matter of urgency, that it is a disgrace that in the 2021-2022 federal budget, it fast-tracks climate collapse, pouring more new money into the coal, oil and gas industry. Now, that's exactly what last night's budget did, as if the fossil fuel sector wasn't already getting enough public support, with fossil fuel subsidies running at almost $9 billion a year. Well, last night, that got increased. And then they got a whole new bucket of subsidies to add to that existing, already obscenely large bucket of subsidies. And I'm going to go through the figures with each of the indefensible amounts of public money that have been given not just to these big corporations, but to these big corporations and mining billionaires that are wrecking the planet and making life difficult and more difficult for all of us. So not only did last night's budget do absolutely nothing to help the transition to 100% clean renewable energy, which will create more jobs and might help us save what's left of the Great Barrier Reef, not only was there a complete absence of climate action, but this government is actively funding climate collapse. The obscene amounts of billions of dollars of public money is just utterly reprehensible. So we saw that last night was a pre-election sweetener that really failed to make billionaires and big corporations pay their fair share of tax whilst fast-tracking climate collapse. Now, of course, instead of taxing the billionaires, we've got stage three tax cuts locked in, and instead of making the big corporations pay their fair share, the budget's full of corporate welfare. Instead of investing in planet-saving, nation-building infrastructure, it hands billions to fossil fuel companies, further accelerating the climate crisis. So, to those fossil fuel subsidies that I talked about, there's $1.1 billion in new money to oil, gas and coal. Next year, it goes up to $11.4 billion. And over the forwards, there's a total of $51 billion, that's billion with a B, in public money going to fossil fuel corporations. Now, that is one of the biggest handouts to the fossil fuel industry in a federal budget ever. And we are in a climate crisis. Honestly, you could not design a worse policy, a worse use of public money than to prop up a polluting industry, one in three of whom already pays no corporate tax and who are pocketing all sorts of corporate largesse anyway, that are also making the climate crisis worse. And meanwhile, we have this government who just vetoed giving public money to a wind farm with a battery backup for reasons that remain known only to the minister himself. So you've got an active war on giving public support to clean energy, and they are falling over themselves to give more public money to fossil fuels, flying in the face of every single climate scientist on the planet and flying in the face of the desperate calls from the community, in particular from the young, for urgent climate action to protect their future, and flying in the face of all of the calls from anyone in a low-lying area where saltwater incursion is making it hard for people to grow food and where natural disasters are increasing in severity, in frequency and in destructiveness. So you just could not design a worse approach. So some of the new absolute doozies that the government's come up with, it's not enough that they give cheap fuel to the likes of Gina Rinehart and other big mining billionaires. It's not enough. And can I just put on record, we do not object to the diesel fuel rebate for farmers. That has always been our policy, to not object to that, and I think Minister Birmingham tried to make an issue of that earlier today, so I'll just have the opportunity to correct the record there. But that's only about an eighth of that fossil fuel subsidy, I might add. So we've still got that cheap diesel to the likes of Gina. We've got various concessional excises on aviation gas, on alternative fuels. Gas-fired recovery gets $31 billion. So this government is so in bed with oil and gas and coal, and they're trying to champion gas as the solution? Like, no. Wrong way. Gas is a fossil fuel. You've often got to wreck farmland to get to it. You've then got to use more energy to liquefy it for export, where it bumps up the prices for domestic gas consumption. There is no saving grace in it whatsoever. And the fact that those gas companies make massive donations to your political party is not enough for you to sacrifice our collective future and a livable climate. For shame. But no, $31.9 billion for a so-called gas-fired recovery. Various other fossil fuel subsidies here, accelerated depreciation, deduction for coal, oil and gas exploration, because you're now paying them to do their job so that they can make squillions in private profits but not pay tax while they wreck the climate. What a great idea, said no one ever, except you lot who take their massive donations. Advancing gas-fired recovery, something called strategic basin plans, which when you look at the fine print is trying to open up the Galilee and the North Bowen to gas. I thought you were trying to open it up for coal, but now you want to open it up for gas as well. Well, the First Nations mobs are not going to be impressed whatsoever, because they haven't given their consent to your attempt to extract coal from those regions, let alone your attempt to now speed up gas extraction. So that's just some of the new fossil fuel subsidies, but of course the continuing ones—no, I take it back, they're the old ones. There's a whole new list of new ones that they've added to. There's an additional $1.1 billion in subsidies. They want to accelerate carbon capture and storage, which is like a unicorn. I'm sorry to my kids who still might think they're real. It's just never going to happen. And if private industry want to use their own money to try and make it work, well, go for it. But why on earth should you get public subsidy rather than just reducing your emissions and transitioning to clean energy sources? There's money for gas roads upgrades in the Northern Territory. Again, I know a few First Nations mobs that are desperately underwhelmed at that suggestion. I've unfortunately run out of time because the list of fossil fuel subsidies is so long, 7 minutes has not been enough for me to go through all of them. This government, once again, is just doing the bidding of oil, coal and gas, and they don't give a damn about the climate or the community.
Thank you, Senator. Senator Abetz, you have the call.
Good environmental stewardship is something that we in the Coalition believe in and believe in exceptionally strongly. It makes sense, and that is why we are delivering. We are delivering, for example, with our plan, which beats our Kyoto targets, and we're on track to meet and beat our 2030 target in relation to the reduction of CO2 emissions. But something that I won't subscribe to is the scaremongering and the sort of language that we are facing climate collapse. This has been the mantra now for decades on end, with prediction after prediction being made and coming in as false, unsubstantiated. So, for example, Madam Acting Deputy President, how often have we heard in the media of this country that, for example, the Maldives is about to disappear under the water? Indeed, we have been told that the Maldives, if we were to believe the predictions, had disappeared and the population had no drinking water for the past 28 years. They were the predictions being made 28 years ago that this was about to happen. Well, they've kept on for those 28 years, but even more interestingly, for those that might be listening and wondering what has happened to the Maldives that is under such existential threat of climate change and is sinking under the water, Foreign Affairs Questions on Notice provided me with this information. We understand from publicly available information that a number of infrastructure projects have been undertaken in Maldives in recent years, including bridges, airports and tourism-related infrastructure. Who on earth would invest in these things if they believed they were going to disappear underwater tomorrow or the next day? And what's more, these include the ongoing expansion of the Valana International Airport. The government of the Maldives further announced in 2019 that not one, not two, not three, not four, but five new airports would be built. This in a country that is allegedly going to disappear underwater, and that prediction has now been made year after year after year. And 28 years ago, all that was supposed to be happening, yet people are still confident in investing in the Maldives with not one but five new airports and new hotels. Who on earth would be making such an investment if they honestly believed that their investment would be underwater within the next few years? But we as a government believe that it is appropriate to look at the issue of good environmental stewardship, not on this sort of hyperventilation and false predictions, but on dealing not with ideology but with technology, asking the question, can we clean up the atmosphere? The answer is yes. Can we do that in a responsible, measured way? Yes. Hence, we've been able to beat our Kyoto targets, and we're on track to meet and beat our 2030 target. And how do we continue to do that? By looking at technology, by seeing what can be done to see if we can invest some of our funding for this purpose. So we've got a $20 billion fund called the Technology Investment Roadmap, and that is delivering, or that will deliver for us, the technology needed so that we can meet our targets without mugging our economy. And at the end of the day, what we have to accept and realise is that if we want to maintain and keep our standard of living, we need reliable, affordable energy. And something that this nation has not done so well over the last two or three decades has been to invest in baseload energy. I, for one, believe that if you're genuinely concerned about the environmental matters of CO2, chances are nuclear energy would be and should be an option for consideration. Nothing more, just consideration. But to say we will not look at a technology for only one reason, ideology, is to sell our fellow Australians short. What we need is to look at all technologies and consider what is the best and most affordable. And indeed, Madam Acting Deputy President, the reason that Australia is a first world economy is not because we have no regulations. Some would argue we are over-regulated. It's not because we have cheap wages in comparison to the rest of the world. Some might argue they are relatively high. We are blessed to be able to have those relatively high wages in Australia. Or is it that we are so close to other markets in the world? No, it's not. The thing that has allowed us for so long to be a first world economy has been the ability to have cheap, reliable energy. In the 1990s, we had some of the cheapest energy in the world. Today, we have some of the most expensive energy in the world. And then we wonder, why is it that manufacturing has debunked from Australia and gone elsewhere? Well, energy is a vital component in manufacturing, and the market will undoubtedly speak in relation to that. And so when people and the country of my birth in recent times, I understand, Madam Acting Deputy President, that has been so reliant on renewable energy, had a problem with a heavy snowfall. All the solar panels were covered, and when there are heavy snowfalls, there's usually no wind. Guess what? They had to import energy from France made with Australian uranium. And what that teaches us is that renewable energy, nice as it might be, cannot deliver the base load energy unless you've got the blessing of a whole lot of hydro power like we do in my home state of Tasmania. But of course the Greens that are interjecting, Madam Acting Deputy President, and you will remember this, the Greens wanted to stop hydro dams in the early 1980s. And do you know what their alternate energy supply was going to be? A coal-fired power station in the Fingal Valley. So said Bob Brown, the former leader of the Australian Greens, front page of the Mercury, I think it was sometime in October. And sure, Senator Wish Wilson finds that an inconvenient truth, but that's the reality. And if you keep on believing the nonsense of the Australian Greens, such as that which is incorporated in this motion, you come to the situation where you deny good, reliable, baseload renewable energy such as hydro, and in desperation you grasp at anything and you suggest a coal-fired power station. Thank goodness they did not build a coal-fired power station, because Bob Brown would have been and the Greens would have been twixt and between. Could they be demonstrating against the coal-fired power station that they had actually wanted and argued for publicly? And so what I say to the Australian Greens and to my fellow Australians who might be listening into this debate, what we need is good, sound, considered policy. Here we have a government that is investing in my home state of Tasmania with Battery of the Nation, investing in an enhanced Snowy Mountain scheme, and seeking to enhance our capacity to harness gas, which of course is a very important transition fuel as we seek to reduce our CO2 emissions. But this idea that we're in climate collapse, we've heard this now for decade after decade after decade, and every prediction after every prediction has failed. That does not mean that we should not be good stewards of our environment, and we as a government are. And can I remind people in this place that the first Minister for the Environment was in fact a Liberal minister. We are committed to the environment. We can continue to be committed to the environment, but we are also committed to our fellow Australians, their jobs, their livelihoods, and the capacity of our nation through our manufacturing and economic base to be able to provide the monies needed for NDIS, for health, for education, for law and order. And you've got to have a complete policy suite, and that is exactly what the Morrison government is delivering.
Thank you. Senator Lyons.
Thank you, Acting Deputy President. Well, you know, it's another day, it's another year of the Morrison government, and we've heard it all before, and it's 2021, and the climate deniers on the backbench of the Morrison government, who were the same climate deniers who were there on the Turnbull government, and they're the same climate deniers who were there with the Abbott government. I mean, when will this debate stop? Whether it's Prime Minister Morrison handing around the lump of coal in the parliament and declaring that coal is his friend, whether it was Prime Minister Abbott carrying on and saying that Labor's pricing on carbon would make a leg of lamb $20, $100, and whether it's Mr Turnbull, who pretended to actually be someone who did support positive policies on climate change, but the backbench roped him in again. The Morrison government, or the Conservatives in this country, are never going to deliver the clean energy future that Australians deserve and Australians are calling for. They're never going to do it, because that handful of backbenchers have got them well and truly round the neck and refuse to let this country move forward. And that's really what it's come down to. A tiny handful of backbenchers who are holding Australia to ransom, holding Australia to ransom. And it's not so much what was in the budget, but what wasn't in the budget. I have gone personally to great lengths to buy an electric vehicle, something those over there won't support at all. I mean, who could remember, who could forget the last election? with Senator Cash and the Prime Minister saying to tradies that they were going to stand there and not let Labor take their utes away. I mean, electric cars have an enormous capacity, but the choice in Australia is minimal because the federal government is doing absolutely nothing to promote electric vehicles in this country. And not one word, not one sentence, not $1 in the federal budget committed to electric cars. And yet you look to Europe and we see all sorts of subsidies being offered. And the cheapest car, electric car, on the Australian market at the moment is the MG. At $44,000, it's out of the hands of most Australians, and shame on the Morrison government for keeping it there. Shame on you. Not only should we be making more electric cars in Australia, if your budget had some vision and some plan, we could be producing electric cars in this country. But no, those Neanderthals on the backbench who just want to deny that there's any change in our climate, that we actually need to do stuff urgently, supported by the Pauline Hanson One Nation Party, a handful of people holding this whole country to ransom, and quite frankly, shame on you. The other thing that the Morrison government won't tell you the truth about is they always parrot on, we're agnostic about power delivery. We just want to ensure supply. What nonsense. What nonsense. You are not agnostic about power delivery. We know where your heart lies, and it's not with renewables. It's not with wind. I remember in this place when we had that ridiculous inquiry into wind turbines, because you were once again pandering to your backbench and a handful of independents in this Senate at the time who thought that producing wind was somehow the devil's work. I mean, what a nonsense that we spent months doing a trumped-up inquiry just to keep your backbench in line. You're cooking the books on the data because you keep saying Australia will reach the Paris targets. But you know what? The rest of the world and most Australians don't believe you. How embarrassing recently, thank goodness, with the election of Mr. Biden in the US, you've had to tame your rhetoric a little bit. And we saw the pathetic comments and speeches made by Mr. Morrison, trying to pretend that somehow we're world leaders. Most Australians know we are not world leaders, and it wasn't lost on the world leaders in the room that Australia is down the bottom, again because of a handful of backbenchers who just refuse to see the reality of what's in front of them, who have no interest in leaving a better world for their children and their children's children, who just want to be those backbenchers, the handful of them, with their head in the sand, pretending somehow this is all going to go away. So we've seen Australian business get on with it. I was up in Karratha recently visiting Yarra, who really are doing a lot of work with hydrogen. Now, in the last week or so, I'll admit, Mr. Morrison suddenly discovered hydrogen. Apparently we're going to have hydrogen hubs all over the place. But before then, no. You know, I guess it's pretty hard to sit in the parliament with a lump of hydrogen, much easier to sit there with a lump of coal, because that's what your backbenchers want to see. But at least he's moved a little bit on that. But we are, when I talk to business leaders, when I talk to mining, they're quite annoyed, because it's those on that side, it's those in the government who are holding them back. Now, you pretend to be there for business. You're there for the big miners. You're there for big business. And yet, with your antiquated, backward, bottom-of-the-world environmental policies, you are holding back business in this country. They do want to forge ahead. They do want to put electric trucks on the road. They do want to cut their emissions. But where's the incentives from you as a government? Not there. And what was in the budget? Very little And if you've got a plan and a vision for this country and where it's going, it certainly wasn't there last night. No vision, no plan for our future. No clean, green technologies advanced, nothing, just because that backbench just holds you down and holds you back. All we're hearing from Mr Morrison now, who apparently is agnostic about where our power comes from, is a gas-led recovery. Well, if he was truly agnostic, you would be looking at every innovation. You'd be holding your head up. You'd be looking to the world leaders about what they're doing on climate and how they're reducing their energy costs. I remember when Prime Minister Abbott said by repealing Labor's price on carbon, people would save $550 a year on their electricity bills. Weren't you going to fess up and say that just wasn't true? And we've just seen electricity costs spiralling out of control for many consumers. And I'm thankful in Western Australia we're not part of a grid mess. It's nearly as bad as the Murray-Darling Basin, the mess you've made of electricity in this country. But that's what the Prime Minister said. $550 a year better off. What a nonsense. Simply not true. Like the $100 leg of lamb. Like the towns that were going to disappear off the map, according to the climate sceptics opposite. I mean, come on. It is time that someone in your front bench, one of your ministers, actually stood up to those handful of climate deniers and said, we are not going to allow you any longer to hold Australia back. There's a whole clean energy future out there that I certainly want for my grandchildren. It's a little like marriage equality. It was really young people who led that debate because they were sick and tired of older Australians saying to them, it's never going to happen. Well, I can tell you my granddaughter, Charlie, who's 17, and my grandson, who's 22, they can't believe the sort of rhetoric that you come out with. And they're not, you know, they're ordinary average kids. They're ordinary average kids, but they're concerned about their future, the future that you are denying them because of your clinging to old-fashioned, outdated ideas because a handful of your backbenchers won't move. So it is the young people in Australia who are more and more questioning what on earth you are doing, because it's their future that you're denying. It's their future you're holding back. And they want a clean, green future. And just like marriage equality, they just don't know where you are heading with this, and they don't agree with you. Thank you, Madam Acting Deputy President.
Senator Wish Wilson.
Thank you, Acting Deputy President. I was reflecting on the fact that it was actually 9 years ago this week that I got pre-selected to replace Dr. Bob Brown in this place. And I came into parliament as a young senator who had been a campaigner on marine conservation, who'd been a campaigner on climate change. I taught the economics of tackling climate change at the university. This is something I thought deeply about. But I was reflecting on the fact that if you had told me then what I know now, what I have seen in the last 9 years, the changes I've observed that have been put into the scientific literature, to this planet, to our oceans, to our coastlines, to our country, if you'd told me back then, I wouldn't have believed it. I simply wouldn't and couldn't have fathomed the magnitude, how much things have tipped in our climate in the last 9 years. James Cook University this week, some of the most respected coral scientists in the world collaborated and said, we've got the briefest of windows to take radical action on climate change. Or by 2050, they estimated 94% of the world's coral reefs would be disappearing. In the last 5 years alone, we've lost half the coral cover on the world's single biggest organism, the Great Barrier Reef, in the last 5 years. Scientists didn't predict it was possible to even have back-to-back bleachings, mass coral bleachings, until 2050. But we've had three in the last 5 years. six in the last 20 years. They didn't even happen until 1998. There was none recorded in history until 1998. And my home state of Tasmania, Acting Deputy President, your home state, has recorded the biggest marine heat wave in human history, the biggest marine heat wave off our coastlines. We've lost our giant kelp forests. I'm getting sick and tired of talking about it in this place, trying to bring to the attention to the people opposite the chamber and those out there that deny the changes to our climate. It's not just a green problem or an environmental problem. It is an economic problem as much as it is anything else. But first and foremost, it is a political problem because it is a political failure that has allowed this to happen. Now, on the way in my car ride this morning, I saw Extinction Rebellion, as it turns out, protesting out the front here with a truck. And they had a sign saying, if we do nothing, we risk everything. I can say with 100% no doubt in my heart that we do risk everything in our oceans if we don't act now, Acting Deputy President. We risk everything. We risk our fisheries, we risk our coastal communities. We will be bringing up our kids in a planet who will not see what we have seen while we've been alive. Funny enough, after I got pre-selected, I wanted to have a holiday before I started in the Senate, and I took my kids snorkeling on the Great Barrier Reef. In 2012, it's unrecognisable now, and we don't understand the impacts that it's having on our ecosystems. That reef system's connected to the forests, it's connected to the climate and the weather in those areas. Everything is interconnected, and it is changing so rapidly. And yet, in this budget, reflecting on David Attenborough's comments, we can't be radical enough, reflecting on his life on this planet in how we tackle the climate emergency, was there any radical action in this budget? No. Was there any action in this budget on climate change? In the face of this evidence, in the face of this mounting evidence, was there any action at all? Not a thing, except more money for fossil fuel companies, more money for oil and gas projects, more money for coal-fired power stations, more subsidies for big polluters. It's got to stop, Acting Deputy President. We have to change and we have to act. I'm getting fed up, and I know so many Australians are getting fed up with this. Where is the action? This is the biggest challenge we face as a nation and as a planet, and there is nothing in this budget at all to tackle it. Nothing. Why? We have to act, Acting Deputy President, and if my party and my colleagues are the only ones in this place that continue to bang the drum, well, so be it. We are not going away, and there is a federal election, and we'll deal with it then.
Your time has expired. Senator Rennick.
Dear Madam Deputy President, the great Franklin Roosevelt once said, there's nothing to fear but fear itself. So it's good to speak to this urgency motion. Can I just say, for the record, I don't support any subsidies at all to any type of energy. 20 years ago, we were fed the neoliberal line that if we privatised the energy market, the market would fix itself. Well, I can assure you the market hasn't fixed itself. Basically, been shoveling subsidies into all sorts of energy. I'll just quote, we've heard a lot about the fossil fuel subsidies, which I don't think are all that high at all. But I'll go into the renewable subsidies. There's $10 billion for a CE Clean Energy Finance Corporation, $5 billion for the Snowy Hydro, which purely exists just so you can have a big battery for the solar and wind. There's $3.5 billion for a climate solutions package, $2.5 billion for the Australian Renewable Energy Agency, another $1.5 billion for a grid reliability fund that got pulled and has now been used for gas and things like that. So, long story short, just at a federal level, there's been $20 billion in subsidies for renewable energy. And then we've got the state subsidies, whereby we've got the ridiculous proposition that the Queensland state government, for example, is paying foreign renewable providers for their energy, undermining our own homegrown coal, which is basically free and owned by the Queensland people. Cogan Creek coal mine actually sits on the coal mine, just gets funneled straight up the conveyor belt, and it's all free because it's owned by the Queensland people.
That used to generate about $1 to $2 billion in profits for the state government every year. And now, last year, it lost $1 billion because it keeps getting turned on and off. So, look, there's lots of things I think that we should address. I think we've got 10 energy agencies just at the federal level. The whole energy market is completely ruined, and there needs to be a discussion about whether or not we nationalise all the base energy and start again, because it's out of control. But can I say, I just want to jump onto this other point in the point here. There is no climate collapse. There is no climate science. Okay, the field of science that we are dealing with is called thermodynamics, and it's existed for about 200 years. And it was actually, yes, it was actually started by a brilliant young French engineer. It was created, his first theories were created, Nicolas Léo Carnot. And he came up, actually, believe it or not, with the second law of thermodynamics, which was that the entropy of a system always increases. Now, unfortunately, he died at an early age from cholera, so we don't have his papers. But if we move on to the English scientist that took his work up, which of course was Robert Joule, and William Thomson, who later became Lord Kelvin and was the first scientist appointed to the British House of Lords. Now, they came up with the first law of thermodynamics, which is that energy is neither created or destroyed, it's just transformed or transferred. Now, these laws matter because heat is basically transferred in three forms. It's either radiation, which is what we're dealing with when we talk about climate science, convection and conduction. Now, I want to talk about conduction first, because conduction is the main form of heat transfer in the atmosphere. And effectively, that rule applies. So the rule that applies to that is the second law of thermodynamics, and I'll explain it to you. If we have a glass of water, half a glass of water at 10 degrees and half a glass of water at 20 degrees, and we pour one into the other, we know if there's no heat loss, it'll average out at 15 degrees Celsius. Now, what I want you to do is to turn those cups upside down or on their side, and effectively, that's the way the atmosphere works. So the atmosphere is basically one big pressure gradient driven by temperature differentials. So the greater the temperature differential, the faster the convection will be. So we see convection in many forms. We see it in the wind. And the other major form of convection is what's known as evaporative cooling. And that's where we have a change in temperature from a phase change. So, for example, the heat will hit an ocean, the water will evaporate, and it'll go up as water vapour. And then when it gets to a point in the atmosphere where it cools, it gets to its condensation point, it will then basically condense again and fall to the ocean. And that's effectively a cooling point. A cooling process, hence why it's called evaporative cooling, and it doesn't just happen in the ocean. If we go and exercise, for example, you might sweat. That's also known as evaporative cooling, and that is the major form of heat transfer on planet Earth. And what you'll get is you'll get most of that around the equator, where you have these massive convection cells where the heat rises. Now, it has to be said that carbon dioxide does increase radiation in the atmosphere. No one's denying that. But what's very important is to actually understand the degree or the quantify that amount of heat and the direction of the heat and how that process works. So in order to understand that, you need to go back to other laws of physics. So the first one is obviously E equals MC squared, whereby 600 million tonnes of hydrogen are burnt every second and converted into 596 million tonnes of helium and 4 million tonnes of energy. Now, that 4 million tonnes of energy, some of that comes to planet Earth here, and depending on where, in the form of a photon. Now, depending on where that photon was created in the sun, if it was created in the inside part of the sun, it'll have low energy and come here as an infrared radiation. If it was created at the edge of the sun, it'll come here as ultraviolet radiation. And ultraviolet radiation has a lot of energy, and that's why it causes skin cancer, because it actually knocks the electron. Can hit a molecule and actually knock an electron straight out of its orbit, and that ionises the atom, and that's when it becomes oxidative and starts causing things like cancer and things like that. But what's important to understand with carbon dioxide in terms of radiation is that it has four vibrational frequencies. The first frequency is found at 2.8 microns, and that actually refracts incoming infrared radiation. So that's not actually adding to the heat at all in the atmosphere. The second vibrational frequency is at 4.3 microns, and that is that particular frequency has no dipole moment. So that means it's not electromagnetic, and so it neither absorbs or emits. And then we get to the two degenerate modes at 14.8 microns. Now, this is where basically carbon dioxide absorbs and emits heat. And one of the big myths we hear in climate science is that carbon dioxide traps heat. That is an oxymoron. Okay? Heat is kinetic energy, the energy of motion. So every person, every molecule on this earth will basically absorb and radiate heat. If we were to turn the lights off in the chamber now and put an infrared light on you, we'd all be glowing red. Now, what's interesting with the 14.8 micron is that we need to use Wien's law of displacement to determine at what temperature that will radiate. Now, long story short, the formula for that is 2,888 over the frequency of the vibration, which is about 15. So, long story short, it'll radiate at 192 degrees Kelvin, which, if you convert back into degrees Celsius, is negative 80 degrees Celsius. So, long story short, carbon dioxide does emit heat at about negative 80 degrees. So you've got to go somewhere up about 10 or 15 kilometres in the atmosphere to actually get carbon dioxide to actually refract heat. So, long story short, the amount of heat that will increase as a result of increasing carbon dioxide in the atmosphere is very marginal, because let's not forget that while you might have 430 parts per million of carbon dioxide, it's not the biggest greenhouse gas absorber in the planet. The biggest greenhouse gas absorber in the planet just happens to be this thing we call H2O, which is water or water vapour. Now, that at about 75 degrees humidity and 25 degrees Celsius is about 15,000 parts per million. So if we add, you know, another part per million, the increase in heat is what's described as it increases in a negative logarithmic scale. So if I had 10, for example, patty cakes and I got another cake, it increased by 10%. If I had 100 patty cakes and I had another patty cake, it increased by 1%. So gradually the rate of change, and those of you who understand your calculus will know what I'm talking about, diminishes. So long story short, the whole thing about radiative heat is overblown, because most of the heat transferred throughout the atmosphere is through conduction, and the other part of and if it isn't through conduction, it'll be through convection, and if it isn't through convection, it'll be through conduction. And that is where, if one molecule, so it'll absorb a photon, heats up, it'll bang into another molecule, and it passes energy to that other molecule. Now, we'll apply the first law of thermodynamics there. So basically, the energy gained by one molecule will be lost by the other molecule. You cannot increase the overall energy in the system. So long story short, there is nothing to worry about at all. We're not going to have a climate collapse anytime soon. The first time you'd expect to see a climate collapse is in about 3 billion years' time, when the sun starts to burn out and it'll start to blow up into a big red blob, and it'll gradually come out and it'll consume Venus and then Mars and then planet Earth. But you haven't got to worry about that, because we'll probably life on Earth will probably come to an end in about 1 billion years' time, when all the hydrogen is slowly evaporated out of the Earth and water will cease to exist. And as you all know, when water ceases to exist, it's kaput for all of us. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Senator Rennick. Senator Thorpe.
Thank you, Acting Deputy President. I must say, Senator Rennick, that was some speech you gave there of exactly what we're dealing with in this country, and it's climate deniers.
It's called pathy.
So I'll get on with my speech. And I do rise to speak on this matter of absolute public urgency today, because this place cannot ignore that the climate collapse and destruction of country that is happening now on this climate-denying government. Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples have lived sustainably on this land forever. Not 200 years, not 250 years, forever, Senator Stoker. We have song lines across this country that connect us to each other, to our culture, water and sky. We are the caretakers of these lands. Protection of country is at the very core of our culture and connection to the land and sea. Our people are not from country, we are country. The First Nations people of this country have always understood a fundamental thing that this government simply doesn't understand. Our people understand that when it comes to protection of country, everything is connected. everything. Our relationship to lands, waters and sky is inseparable from our understanding of what it means to be a First Nations person. Our people have sustainably cared for these lands and waters for thousands and thousands of generations. We did this by learning from our elders, passing down our knowledge, and our people aren't consumers. We're custodians. We didn't treat the land like something to own. We didn't mine our country, and we didn't frack our country. Generations of our people would take care of country and community. They weren't driven by selfish values of wealth and power. That's what the colonisers brought here, to this place, to this very place. It's all about power and money and greed. Instead, while these colonisers have been here for a tiny fraction of time, our peoples have been on these lands for thousands of generations. And we're faced with the biggest challenge we'll ever face, and that is the climate crisis. In last night's budget, we found out that they'll be handing over $1.1 billion of taxpayers' money to burn the planet even more, to give money to oil and gas and coal industries, to dirty coal, oil and gas barons that are responsible for the destruction of our climate and our country. This government will do whatever their big corporate mates and the mining lobby ask them to do, because reality is both the Liberal Party, the National Party and the Labor Party take dirty donations from developers and mining companies and big corporations. This party does not do that because we have integrity and we make decisions that is based on protecting and connecting with our country and our communities. Last week I was in Borroloola at the MacArthur mine. That's where I saw with my own eyes what the desecration of country for grubby, easy profit is doing to our lands and our local communities. These resources are pulled up out of the ground by the big mining corporation, Glencore in this case, one of the dirtiest ones going, who have absolutely no respect for traditional owners. Big miners across this country divert and suck up water. They mine our lands for coal, for gas. Then our climate gets drier, hotter and more extreme. Our lands suffer. Our waters are poisoned. They dry up. So much pain for so little gain. Right now, we are at a turning point in this country. Colonisers came, they've done as much destruction, extraction and damage to our people, the first people of these lands, just over 200 years. That's what they've been able to do. The decisions we make today in this place will have impacts for every single generation to come. Every single. Every single child, their children, their grandchildren, the decisions made here today will impact on their lives and their livelihoods. But I'm not sure whether the government actually thinks that far forward. It's about what they can take now. Look after their mates now. Stay in power now. Forget about future generations. But the good news is the solution to the climate crisis is here. It always has been. With First Nations people, we have solutions to heal this country. We can't even get a seat at the table, and we all know what that looks like. We, the original sovereign people of these lands, have known it all along. When we care and protect for country, country cares and protects us. We must protect all the living beings belonging to these lands and waters, because we share this country with them too. It's not just an animal or a plant or a tree. We are connected. spiritually and physically, to these living beings. We can grow in renewable, sustainable energy, clean energy from the wind and the sun. We've got plenty of that. We can protect our ancient, precious cultural heritage instead of desecrating it for a quick buck. And we can enjoy our lives in harmony with our planet and with plenty of energy if we get our energy from clean sources. If only this out-of-touch, climate-denying government get out of the way. We're running out of time. Climate deniers need to face the facts. They need to get with the program. They need to understand why we're having extreme weather events before it's too late. And I know that you have your climate-denying scientists that will back whatever climate-denying words you want to talk about. But the reality is you are putting your children's children in extreme danger. And maybe if you think about that for a moment and think about what that means for your family, but also think about the economic impacts that this is going to have on this nation. You know, start thinking the way you think about looking after yourself and making a quick buck, because climate action will help you do that.
Senator Roberts.
Thank you, Madam Acting Deputy President. As a servant to the people of Queensland and Australia, I'll discuss collapses already underway, and none of them involve a climate collapse. Firstly, the economic collapse. In the name of unsubstantiated climate alarm, the Howard Anderson Liberal Nationals government, starting in 1996, colluded with the states to deceitfully bypass the Constitution to steal farmers' property rights to comply with the UN's Kyoto Protocol. It concocted Australia's first major party emissions trading scheme, a carbon dioxide tax to comply with UN dictates. It introduced the renewable energy target that grew to now cost Australians an additional $13 billion each year, every year, above and in addition to their electricity costs, again, to comply with UN dictates. In the name of climate, our electricity prices have risen artificially from the world's lowest to now be the world's highest. Manufacturing has collapsed. We no longer make cars. We make few household appliances. We make no manufacturing tools crucial for our security. Agriculture is being hammered. The Liberal National Energy Minister, Angus Taylor, openly states he has fears for electricity prices, reliability and grid stability. Under this budget's dreamy forecast, bets on hydrogen and continued subsidy of expensive unreliables like wind and solar, we're enduring a manufacturing collapse and we face economic collapse. The second collapse, the collapse of science. Here are some facts. Firstly, on Monday, 26 September 2016, the CSIRO confirmed that it has never stated that carbon dioxide from human activity is a danger and said it never will. So why do the Greens push policies for economic collapse? Why have Liberal, Nationals and Labor governments enacted policies over the last 2.5 decades for economic collapse? Secondly, on Wednesday, the 10th of May 2017, in this building, the CSIRO admitted that today's temperatures are not unprecedented. Not unprecedented. That means we didn't cause the current mild cyclical warming that ended around 1995. So why did the Greens push policies for economic collapse? Why have Liberal, National and Labor governments for the last 2.5 decades driven economic collapse? According to NASA satellites, global atmospheric temperatures have been essentially flat, with no warming for more than a quarter of a century. Despite China, despite India, despite America, despite Europe, despite Russia producing record quantities of carbon dioxide, higher human production of carbon dioxide has not increased temperatures. So why do the Greens push policies for economic collapse? Why have Liberal, National, Labor governments driven for the last 2.5 decades economic collapse? Following the global financial crisis, most nations were in recession during 2009. In 2020, as a result of government COVID restrictions around the world, nations were again in recession. In both recession years, the use of hydrocarbon fuels fell and human carbon dioxide production fell. Yet in both recession years, atmospheric carbon dioxide levels continued increasing. Nature alone controls the carbon dioxide levels. So why do the Greens push policies for economic collapse? Why have Liberal, Nationals and Labor governments driven economic collapse for the last 2.5 decades? Bureau of Meteorology records data on cyclones in Australia shows no trend in cyclone frequency, severity or duration. There's no climate catastrophe. The most severe drought in the last 120 years was the 1920s-40s drought. The next worst was the Federation drought in 1901. There's no climate catastrophe. Floods, bushfires, snowfall and every other climate factor shows no change, just natural cyclical variation. There's no climate catastrophe. It's been 601 days since my latest challenge to the Greens to present the data on which they base this nonsense and to debate me on the climate science and the corruption of climate science. So finally, there's no unprecedented global warming, there's no climate change, there's no climate catastrophe, there's no climate collapse. Instead, we have a collapse of science. The collapse of science led to an early collapse, an energy collapse that caused an economic collapse. Welcome to the Greens' nightmare that is now the Liberals, Nationals, Labor nightmare. This is what happens when data is ignored and instead governance is based on unfounded opinions, personal and party political agenda, cronies, headlines, fear, emotions, UN policies, party donations and serving vested interests. And who pays for this atrocious governance and climate lies? We, the people, pay.
Senator Roberts, your time has expired. Senator Stilljohn.
Thank you, Acting Deputy President. The climate crisis, and we are in a climate crisis, sits alongside the continued existence of nuclear weapons on our planet as the two greatest threats to the peace and well-being of our human community. This is the reality of the moment in which we live. This is the reality of 2021. For the nations, and particularly for the island nations of our Asia-Pacific region, climate change is not a far-off abstract. It is a present reality, as it is for the fire-ravaged communities of Australia, as it is for the farmers, and it is for all those whose lives and livelihood depend on the land. It is something observed by people who, in their lifetimes, have seen changes in their environment around them, in their communities, and it is something that is observed by those who can trace their connection to country back hundreds of generations. This federal budget presented another opportunity for action. Action to create a sustainable and safe and inclusive future for everyone. Action to create safe, sustainable jobs. Action to support those currently working in fossil fuel industries to transition to new, renewable, clean industries. These were all of the potential opportunities on the table which the Morrison government could have taken. And yet what this budget has revealed is a government which is interested in only one thing: serving its corporate donors. Serving its corporate donors, who yesterday filled this place like lice, scurrying about, trying to find and identify just exactly what they got for all those donations and all those dinners, going through the budget line by line, identifying exactly what they got for their time. It was revolting. And a whole bunch of them were grinning with the additional $1 billion that this government has decided to give to the fossil fuel industry every single bloody year over the next 4 years. You know what? I've had so many of these debates in this place over the last 4 years, where the Greens have contributed science and evidence. This movement has spent decades, the community has spent decades, putting forward detailed plans, stepping out exactly how we do this, and all of the reasons why. Young people have driven ourselves into the ground, trying to get the attention of the major parties, get them to act. We have struck, we have disrupted, and we have given our time. Young people so often make the journey to Canberra or to their state parliament and make the case for their own future. The reality is, and it is reminded to me on nights like last night, that the problem isn't that you people don't know that climate change is a thing. The problem is that you don't care. You don't give a damn. You'd rather go to a dinner with a miner or the pokey industry or a gas merchant or the owner of Harvey Norman than take action on climate change and safeguard our future. And that disgraceful disregard is exactly why the young people of this country, come the next election, will vote you out of office. And good riddance to the lot of you.
Thank you, Senator Steele John. The time for the discussion has expired. So the question before the chair is the motion that has been moved by Senator Thorpe be agreed to. Those of that opinion say aye.
Aye.
Those against say no.
No.
I think the noes have it. Division required. Ring the bells. 4 minutes. Lock the doors. The question is that the motion moved by Senator Thorpe be agreed to. The ayes will move to the right of the chair, the noes to the left. I appoint Senator Seewert, teller for the ayes, and Senator Urquhart, teller for the noes. There being 9 ayes and 28 noes, the question is resolved in the negative.